Blessing. And I do blessing things. Blessing. And when I do them, I always smile. Because blessing makes the world go round. Yes, blessing makes the world go round.
All of these doves. In this video, I'm going to show you doves how I... Where is it? How I decorated my metal tin that now houses my gouache paints. I'm trying to do this all one-handed because one hand is holding you peace doves, and I don't want to drop you doves. See, so it's got all my colors in it. I'm gonna show you doves how I decorated it and did all that beautiful stuff. And because back in April, my plastic paletto completely fell apart on me, and that really, really sucked. And so I got this metal paletto, and I'm just gonna show you doves how I decorated it and everything. I gotta get my little red noses up in here. The video, I'm trying to make it as like not incredibly long, but it's a lot of footage that I'm having to go through. It was tough having to edit it because this whole process took multiple days because I kept making multiple mistakes. And so I just really hope that you doves enjoy it, and I should be posting more videos soon, because I didn't really post anything last month because I was doing like the giveaway, which congrats to Peace Dove Carmen, who won the Murphy painting and the necklace. And also in making that giveaway, the video editor that I was using, it was giving me so many problems, and it exported things so slowly that I was like, you know what, I need to go through the search again of trying to find another video editor. And I finally found one, and this will be the first video that I've made with it. And I also made my very first animated transition scene. I only did one. I wanted to make two last month, but I only had the mental capacity to do one. But that's okay. One is better than none. So y'all are gonna be seeing that every time there's a new title sequence. And so I've just been doing quite a lot. There's just been a lot going on in my personal life that I don't really want to talk about. And yes, I know I'm talking really fast, but that's because I really want to get into this video. So I just wanted to update y'all with all that. So let's fly into the video! Let's unbox this now. I'm so excited. Like, I know I talk a lot. That's kind of a trait of a Blessing VH Art video. And it's weird because I'm actually really, really introverted, but I do tend to talk a lot. So here is the box. It's more like a blush pink or a baby pink. It's not like a, you know, like a punch you in your face pink. Now Paul Reubens, this is not the actor Paul Reubens, this is the painter Paul Reubens. If I remember correctly, he did quite a few oil paintings. I tend to get Reubens, Rembrandt, Renoir confused because all their names start with R, and I have a really thick Renoir book in my library, and I love his paintings, but I tend to get all three of their names confused. But Paul Reubens is a painter. That's what his face looks like. He's dead, but that's what his face looks like. I always love it whenever art companies name their supplies off of people. Like Faber-Castell, their watercolor pencils are called the Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencils, off of the artist Albrecht Dürer, who made this really beautiful, I can't remember if it was an etching or if it was paint, but it was his version of Jesus, you know, of Nazareth or whatever. And it was very striking and very stylized. It was Greek, or was it German? I can't remember where he was from. We only briefly talked about him, but It was very just striking, a portrait of Jesus from Nazareth. And a lot of the Renaissance painters really liked his rendition, despite he made that long before the Renaissance, if I remember correctly. So I just think that's kind of cool how Faber-Castell has an entire line of pencils named after that guy. There are other companies that name their stuff after people too. But 9 times out of 10, if there's an artist type of line of paint, it's not named after a famous actor, it's named after an artist. But I do know that there's an actor called Paul Reubens, so not that Paul Reubens. I just thought I should let y'all know. Hang on, this box is not wanting to come off. Oh my gosh, this is so beautiful! Holy cow! And this cloth, it feels really like it's not cheap, like it's gonna tear in a few minutes. This actually does feel really, really cool. And this is like fancy print, like it's not gonna peel on me. Oh my gosh, this pink, I didn't realize it would be so much of a baby pink. Oh, this has a little bit of weight to it. So this is the metal tin that I was telling you P-Stubs about. At least I think I mentioned it in my last blog or article or whatever. So whenever you hear particularly watercolorists talk about having a metal tin for their paletto of colors, they generally mean something this size or bigger. So it's completely metal, and it's a tin. And so when you open it, this particular one is pink and has Paul Reubens' face, but they normally come in a black, and I didn't want a black. And sometimes with some companies, they have their company logo right here or right here. Sometimes not. It just depends on the company. So when you open it, these are mixing areas, but you also have this extra mixing area, which some people in some reviews said that this doesn't lay, that this bends, but this one actually is a bit, it tends to lay flat, which, I mean, I lucked out, but I'm still taking this part out anyway. And so this is the metal flap that I was telling y'all about that we're fixing to remove. And I wish this was washed before it got to me. Can y'all see that? That's a little QC there. Oof. But we're gonna take that flap off anyway. I think this is their brochure. Yeah, so these paints are made in China. I think I mentioned in my last blog article / video that I actually have always been interested in watercolors because I love Eastern watercolor paintings. Not even like just anime. And I mean more like the really old antique watercolor folk art type of style. That's always just been like a really big thing with me. Add to the fact that when I was like 8 years old, that Sagwa cartoon by Amy Tan had first came out, and that was sort of like my exposure to Eastern cartoons that wasn't anime. So it wasn't as stylized. It was much more Chinese style than Japanese, obviously, because Amy Tan is Chinese, if I remember correctly. And this looks like, yeah, this is the little swatch card. It comes with a swatch card for all these colors. And I think the art community watercolorist, they say if you pull, so this tray is removable, which we are going to remove it for what I plan on doing with it, but these little pans, if you pull these little metal teeth thingies back, these little pans pop out. So this is what's called a watercolor pan. And two of these, sometimes companies sell two of these like as like one thing, so that would be a full pan, but these are half pans. because it's half of a full pan. And here, let me put this up closer to you, pea stoves. It's actually really tiny, y'all. I didn't realize how tiny these were because I've never actually used artist quality watercolors before, or even I've never really used anything better than Crayola. I have tried the Dallaire Round Leaf Simply watercolors. They were in that DIY My Own Watercolor Ground, but that was from tubes that someone already squirted out in a paletto, so I've never had the whole pan watercolor experience. But this tray, I'm not going to be using this tray either. And these watercolors and the swatch and everything, I'm going to be putting them in a different paletto. So I'm not going to actually be using these till probably around my birthday as like a present to myself, because there are some, there's like two colors in here that I can't use because they're toxic. Yeah, the cadmium yellow medium and the cadmium red light are made with, I think they're made with the pure cadmium pigment, which is toxic, and I don't like using toxic stuff in my studio, so I'm gonna be selling these two. But you know, I'll talk more about that in the actual watercolor video, which is not right now. So this is, oh man, it is not clean in here. Oh boy, let me give this a little scrub down with my cloth. Oh wow, that really was easy. So I can take, I stuck this nail, there's like a little hole, you probably can't see it, but a little hole right here that has this little metal part in it. So I stuck this nail through and it popped out, so I can take this out and, okay, well that actually was pretty easy. So it looks like, I don't think I'm going to like reattach it, but oh, I see. So if I wanted to reattach this, which I probably don't think I ever will, I can line this up, or if like you have one and it gets broke, I can line this up and stick this metal rod just right through all the holes. See? Okay. Well, these can go into the box. So that I don't lose them. Because I mean, it's a mixing tray, so I can probably find like a different purpose for it. And I'll put these colors and stuff in here too. Well, I guess that means I really don't need this or this. But it never hurts to come prepared, you pea stoves, okay? That's one thing you can learn from this video. Never hurts to come prepared. And these hinges, because I thought these hinges were going to be very sharp, but it looks like they're rolled, so I'm not having any problems with like, you know, accidentally cutting myself. Let me see, in case you pea stubs want to buy this set of watercolor, are these edges sharp? Okay, so these are rolled. These might be, these don't feel sharp. They just feel a little scratchy, so in case y'all wanted to know that. Let me put that away. Okay, so welcome to the back of the tin and the front of the tin. So I saw a Frugal Crafter video where she basically customized a tin that had paints that she didn't like in it, and she used like alcohol inks and a whole lot of other stuff that I don't have. And I don't actually buy alcohol inks because I don't really like, it's not archival, so whatever I would make with it, I would have to sell only prints of it. And I have these markers because my mama, she went through a phase where she liked using alcohol markers for her fashion drawings. So she got like these, and I of course have the Sharpies, but she got like these art markers with like the double sides to them, and like from different brands, but she mainly liked this Copic brand. And like, I have a video where I took one of the gray Copic markers and turned it into my own water brush. That's like, you know, from way, way back when. It's a blog article too. But she gave me and my sister her like marker stash. We split it in half because she realized she liked the results that she gets when she uses watercolors instead of alcohol markers, which is totally fine because it's archival too. So I have these for like the alcohol inks, but I also thought, I didn't see this in the Frugal Crafters video, but I thought, you know, nail polish is enamel paint. So what if I were to put enamel on top of enamel and see what happens? So what I was going to do, just create a bit of an abstract pattern with these markers and then start layering with nail polish and then finish with like gorgeous top coats. Like, this is one of my favorites. It's called Pride. The Sinful Colors is one of my favorite nail polish brands from Walgreens. They're really cheap, but I also really like them. And this one glows in the dark, and so does this one. It's got little moons in it. I haven't tried this one yet, but I do love Sally Hansen nail polish. My mama gave this one to me for Christmas, and it was in my travel bag, but I forgot that I had it till like a few weeks ago. And this is standard glitter nail polish. So we're gonna do that. And I have this petroleum jelly here because, a little life hack, if you open up your nail polish, you want to like rub the like top part of the glass with this petroleum jelly, so that way your polish won't stick to itself anymore. It won't get stuck, is what I'm trying to say. So I'm gonna be silent. Possibly, I'm pretty sure I might end up doing this in the time lapse, because this isn't like a full-on artistic rendition, and I'm probably just gonna put some music on it. I know I don't really like doing the whole time lapse thing, but for things like this where it's just not really a rhyme or reason to what I'm doing, I think it'd be okay to do it. So we're gonna do that.
Thank you.
this is the state of my desk. It's not a desk. It's actually, I am pretty sure it is a living room table, but I use it as my desk. And it is definitely a multi-purpose art desk because I do not stick with one artisan or craft. I tend to swap everything out just about every week or so. But this is the state of things. And I will explain why caulking has decided to make an appearance. And with my nail polishes, over here we have my base coats. And over here we have my top coats. And I use those respectively in the making of this. And that is my Paul Reubens box. And as you can see, there's blue all over the Paul Reubens box. The cloth that the Paul Reubens watercolors came with is not pink anymore. My box cutter is now two different colors, even though when I bought it, it used to look like this. It used to be this shade of white, or roughly close to the shade of white, and now it's not. So I'll just leave you more artistic piece doves, a big guess as to what shade of blue I tend to use. Everything's gonna get covered in blue again because I still have to move these paints over, but I managed to kind of clean off my paletto knife, so that's good. So the box, the paletto metal tin, looks like this. This is the back side, and this is the front side. And when I was painting it, I originally composed it this way. Oh, there's a glare. We'll have to deal with that. I composed the back side this way, and so the front side kind of echoes that, even though I wasn't directly painting it and painting the front side in this orientation. So this is kind of the way I see it as an artist, but I really like, I intentionally made a more abstract floral pattern so that no matter what orientation I happen to pick it up as, it can be pleasant to look at. So I showed you the back. Let me show you the edges and then I'll show you the front. So I am very proud of the way this red looks. I was not expecting that. It is this company, Rimmo London, and Red Steady Go is the shade. It is so bright, and I call that my poppy flower. I like red poppies. I even put it on the front because the front looks a bit different than when I last saw you piece stuffs. It has been several days since all this was painted, and I'll tell you why. And so here is this other edge, and you'll see some blue paint fingers. I need to wash that, but I'm not entirely sure it's going to come out, and that is okay. Got that handmade look to it. I really like the way this front part looks right here. I mean, I love the whole thing, but this like front part, it looks very watercolory, which is really, really cool. And this side too looks that way as well. Very cool. And then here is the front. Oh. Gotta make sure you're all in focus. As you can see on the front, I went mega crazy with the glitter because I felt like it. And these little black things are skull and crossbones. One of my glow-in-the-dark colors has little skulls and crossbones in it, so I made sure to put that there. And the other glow-in-the-dark color has these little crescent moons, which is pretty cool. So I made sure to put that there. And this little flower is supposed to mimic or echo this little flower and this blue flower is supposed to echo that, and this sporadic giant green is supposed to echo that. Green and purple are my favorite color. So when this happy accident happened, I wanted to recreate it as a not so as a non-accident but an intentional effect, because I had just learned it, and so it worked out pretty well. So when I think the last time I filmed, I said I was going to put glue gun in here, and I actually tried that twice, and both times was a fail, because I've been using plastic palettes for so long that I didn't realize that a glue gun would not really adhere to here. I mean, it would, kind of, but just any small, like, bump or tick like this, or... So, let me narrate what happened as it happened. So, I did one glue gun structure that looked kind of like this, where I follow the pink lines here. But the problem was, after I did that, I went through the trouble of actually scooping out all of this paint from these flaps. And so I was having to scoop out, here, let me move all this stuff to the side. I was having to scoop out all this paint, and so you can see my fingers are progressively getting discolored. And so that was a bit of a process. So we scooped it all out into here. Bear in mind, this was with the old glue gun, the first glue gun iteration. And after I scooped all the paint in here, I was kind of happy, but then I realized how uneven these wells were in size. So the wells over here were the smallest, and I made these two wells the largest because that's where my white and my white will go. So I left the whites in these two wells, and I made the painstaking process of using my box cutter, which I really shouldn't have done that, but nothing bad happened. It's just it left a couple scuff marks, and I cut down these legs on each well as I slowly scooped out the paint, and I left the white cross right here intact. And it was a big mistake, because then, as you can see, the sink white has been a little bit runny. So this leg, it started to pop out, and I didn't realize it, and I kept moving the tin around as I was slowly putting in a new glue gun skeleton. I say skeleton because I have the second iteration of this glue gun skeletal structure, and it reminds me of a ribcage, kind of. Or, like, you know, a spinal column, and these, like, things go, like, eventually around your body. And so the sink white started running into the titanium white, and so then I had to pull this part out, and I redid it. But then after I redid it, the whole thing, I realized that part of it was popping out because I kept moving the tin around and everything. So the colors, these colors all started to run into each other, and I got really upset. So I had to completely pull the whole thing out and let it dry, because I think the glycerin is very shiny. It's very shiny. I think the glycerin was making it so that the glue gun wasn't adhering to the metal, but also the glue gun plastic doesn't really adhere to metal, or according to this completely unscientific test or whatever, it doesn't really do that. So I was like, what adheres to metal? And I found that caulking does, or, well, at least it says it on here, it adheres to metal, and Google said it too. So I decided I don't have a caulking gun, so that's why these lines, this rib cage looks so terrible. So I did multiple layers. I think I did like five layers. I did it like five layers with the glue gun as well. But before I put down the caulking, I completely redid my marker. So the second time I did the glue gun, so before the caulking, I used these red marks, but it still wasn't right. So what I ended up doing, I took one of the half pans from here, and I kind of shoved it in the corner like so, but I wanted to make the wells bigger than that of a half pan. So these aren't the size of a half pan, and if I go like this, you can see they're actually quite bigger than a half pan. Because I mean, I could have made it so that I could fit 12 colors here, but that would have made my whites really small. And I don't want to do that because it's like one of the colors I use the most. And so I now have 10 wells. I made yellow became the third color, or well, actually it's more of a peach color, but it looks yellow. But I've basically just been letting this dry, and as you can see, it is very stiff and it is sticking, which I am happy about. And so I am now going to scoop these colors into here. Alrighty, I hope you peace doves enjoyed watching that video. I actually took out quite a bit of footage because like when it came to me you know, gluing in all of those little glue gun thingies to make the wells, I took all of that out because the final product has caulking in it and not glue gun, and I kind of talk about that in the video and everything. And I also write about it in my blog, which if you really want more details about all of that, you can read my blog and stuff. And so I took out like a lot of footage, but like I was still filming. Like I filmed so much. Oh, I think this entire process took like a week and a half, honestly. But I am so happy with my 10, and sometimes it's one of those things where sometimes you gotta, you know, be willing to work with stuff despite the fact that it takes forever to execute what you see in your head. But I am just that stubborn to where, you know, I am like willing to, what do you call it, go through, like walk on all these eggshells if I know I'm gonna get what I want. And that's kind of the insane part of me that makes running a business so successful, you know, because small business owners are kind of known for doing really insane things because they know that in the long run it's gonna benefit them in some way. So I tend to do that with like everything despite it not being a part of my small business. Well, actually I take it back, it actually is, because it's where my paint is and it's how I'm able to paint on the go. And I know I mentioned in the video that I wanted to like test it out with you doves, and so I had a bit of footage of that, but I cut it out because this video would have been too long. And so what I'm gonna do, I actually, around the ending of April, which is, yeah, it was the ending of April, I had my first plein air session with like this kit that I'm using. Oh, sorry. With this kit that I'm using, and with you know, these gouache colors and stuff. So I filmed all of that, and this, like, I'm quite proud of the footage that I made and everything. And so that, I decided that is going to be my video of where I'm actually testing out my gouache paletto, this metal tin and everything. That way this video isn't, you know, ridiculously long and stuff. So that'll be, I'll be making and editing that video and blog sometime in the future, but I have some other projects that I would like to film right now, which is why I'm trying to get all this this video up and done and off my memory card and everything. So I really hope you devs enjoyed it. If you love this video, or if you loved my blog article, or if you love both, it would mean the world to me if you became a member of the Peace Staff Nest. Link is down below in the Kokorup too. It is blessingvh.art/gimme. Becoming a member of the Peace Staff Nest, you get, well, normally it's weekly newsletters, but it's, I'm now calling it often newsletters because sometimes I can't post every week. But you also get super secret discount coupons that I never share with the general public. You get sneak peeks on future collections that I'm working on. You also get to contribute to future collections because sometimes I ask the members of the Peace Dove Nest, like, just, you know, small little questions about certain patterns, colors, and things, and that ends up being in, like, a future collection, and, it's sort of like, you know, y'all are contributing to the future of Blessing VH Art if you're members of the Peace Dove Nest. And so you get to do all those super fun things. And also, we used to have a Facebook group, but we no longer have a Facebook group because I'm trying to create a different group on a different social media platform because several people in the art community have talked about their own Facebook horror stories. So I'm trying to create like a different group on this different social media platform called MeWe, which is what a couple artists recommended, and they were saying, you know, the reason why Facebook is such a monolith and why it's not accommodating to small businesses is because it is a monolith, but the best way to like create competition for Facebook is to actually start using other platforms that are not Facebook, you know, because whenever something becomes like a monopoly on something, they kind of set all the rules and everyone just kind of just like, well, that's just the way things are, but it shouldn't have to be that way. So this one artist I looked at, she recommended I use MeWe, so I'm trying to figure out how to use MeWe. And so I've just been really busy, but I really hope y'all enjoyed this video and become a member of the Peace Dove Nest. That is the best way to get in touch with me, and a new social media group for us will be coming soon. But you know, y'all can always chit chat on the blog articles too, you know. I think that'd be good if y'all did that. Anyway, I love you Peace Dove so much, and I will see y'all again soon. Adios! Oh, you like this? It shakes. See? Boop, 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 boop